Thank you so much for such an informative evening. The reason I came here is my father died as a result of GMO, agriculture. He died at 78 in 2013. And when I went to his funeral, I came from Uganda, been here more than 20 years. I'm a student at Sydney Uni doing public health. I encountered something that I hadn't known because of living here. My mom would say that we were trying to have the seed banks, but then the government would send in these people who would just go and terrorize them, basically, all those who are trying to grow the organic foods that they used to grow. And they would pull out all their crops from the gardens, which were organic, and force them to grow the GMO foods. Unfortunately, for most of them, because they are peasants, they've never gone to school. They never gave them enough training of how to use the chemicals that GMO foods is supposed to go with. And so my dad would go into the gardens with bare hands and use some of these banned chemicals from industrialized countries. And then from then on, his health deteriorated. He rang me here and said, "Daughter, all the old men are dying because of the foods they are forcing us to grow in our own communities. And if we try to grow the foods that we know are good for us, they send in all these young men and they just uproot them from our gardens." Now for a woman who is trying to fight for her father's name, how can I go in there and try to change that and save my mother who is now sick? Now, a majority of people in the village are now sick because most of the foodstuffs they are getting from the ground can't sustain them. They don't have enough nutrients in them, and they are forever going hungry. I'll give you an example. They used to grow cassava when we grew up in the 70s, 60s. One would have one cassava plant and it will feed a family for 1 week. But now in the GMO cassavas, they are forcing them to grow. You can have a big garden as big as this room and it won't even feed you for 1 week because you need to uproot more than 20 of them, the cassava plants, just to get enough for one meal. How am I able to go in there? Because that's why I'm doing this master's in international public health, to go and help my people fight this disease, the GMO disease that is killing them through the chemicals and killing them through hunger. What would you suggest?
Well, you know, you've already taken a major step by deciding to do a public health degree to go back and help your community. Because under the industrial model, agriculture is made to look like it's about producing industrial commodities. And I said only 10% of the corn and soya is being eaten. The rest is biofuel and animal feed. Your work is very important. Because what we've to redefine agriculture as is the production of health, health of the soil, health of people, of quality, of joy, of pleasure, of nutrition, of everything that makes a good life. I would say two things. One is do make contact with Adam, who's sitting in the row behind you, to build a campaign on the GMO banana, for which Uganda is being used as the Trojan horse. But the reality is that this would be a way to introduce genetically engineered banana everywhere. You're already growing it in Queensland. And the idea basically is, as I said, and if you have to figure out if they're going to make money out of patenting, you just have to hear them say, "And I'll give it to the poorest farmers for free." The minute they say they'll give it to the poorest farmer for free, you can be sure they'll make huge money from the rest. And there'll be some symbolic giving of patent-free genetic material. The second is, you know, we've now got global movements, and this is an expression of it. And when we saved seeds, we had to declare we are going to save seeds against the law, the seed satyagraha. And I know Gandhi is known in Uganda, because I've seen his statue when I went to advise the government there 20 years ago. So build seed sovereignty and seed freedom. build the movements for food sovereignty and food freedom. And one of the organizers of this meeting is Spinifex. By early March, they're going to bring a book out that I've edited on seed sovereignty and food security, women in the vanguard. It's got some of this cutting edge science on what's happening with GMOs in health. It's got a lot of papers on seed saving. Make it something you can share with women back in Uganda. And 2nd of October, from 2nd of October, which is Gandhi's birth anniversary, to 16th of October, which is World Food Day, we celebrate a fortnight of seed freedom and food democracy. And 2nd is the day that United Nations now recognizes as the day of satyagraha and nonviolence, the duty to engage in the right actions against a dominant order. So share with your people, go visit the Seed Freedom website, all of you, I would suggest. Seed Freedom is about everyone's action, it's your platform. There's a Seed Freedom Declaration, make it your own in Uganda. And I know when the Ugandan women will decide that their seeds and their food will be in their hands and agriculture will be for health of their people and their community and Mother Earth, that's the day all these bullies will disappear.